since man has first walked upright billions of years ago. He has been a hunter, a fisherman, and he's lived off the land.
Okay, all right. Well, not billions of years ago, because, you know, dinosaurs only went extinct about, you know, like maybe, what, 65 million years ago? And, oh, yeah, okay. Sometimes in those science fiction movies, you see, like, a Tyrannosaurus Rex eating some cave guy? That couldn't happen. There's no way, because, like, humanoids, they've only been around, like, for, like, I don't know, maybe a few million years, whereas, and real people have only been around, like, maybe a couple hundred thousand. Okay, and by real people, what I mean is, like, Homo erectus. Don't, okay, I know you're laughing, but don't even, because this is a real term. These are the people who existed between, like, Neanderthals and, like, the Flintstones, right in there, that special time. And they're the ones, they developed tools, like the Phillips and the flint knife, and they used to throw bones in the air. Like that movie 2001, ever see that? Did not understand that movie whatsoever, I'll tell you that. That, like a black cartridge or something. It's like a Nintendo game cartridge. I had no idea.
Thank you, Harold.
I'm sorry.
Here he is, the star of the Red Green Show, Red Green.
Thank you. Welcome to Possum Lodge. Overstaying his welcome is Harold there. Harold is my producer and director, and due to an unfortunate family situation, he's also my nephew. Harold has eaten up most of our time with his stream of unconsciousness there.
I'm sorry, Uncle Red. Sometimes I just get ideas, and I can't stop it. So here comes an idea right now. Here it comes. Was that cool and or hip or what?
Well, that's eating up even a little more time. So I'm gonna have to keep things moving very quickly. Now I'm running out of time, very little time left. I haven't got any, you know, I sound exactly like Kreskin.
I like Kreskin. Kreskin was good. Wasn't he one of the better ones? I thought he was really something else. He was so true. David Copperfield, he was good too. He made the Statue of Liberty disappear. Oh, where are you gonna put that? Your closet? I don't even think so. I'm sorry, Uncle Red. You go right ahead with what you're doing.
Thank you, Harold. Well, in the 3 seconds I have left, I thought I would mention that the lodge has gone for a new life insurance policy.
That, you should tell that story. That's a really good story to tell, because you know it better
than
me.
Shut up, Harold.
I'll be right.
So we all had to have examinations, but the problem was that Glenn Braxton flunked his exam. I mean, his physical was so bad, I think his cholesterol was 5,000 over something. And they ended up taking away his driver's license, which means he can't drive his beloved RV. Well, I'll tell you, Glenn is not a happy camper. In fact, he's not a camper at all.
Did you see 2001? What was that? Who was Hal?
Just do the next segment, would you, Harold?
Right, okay.
Life stinks. That's the whole deal. Life stinks.
Yeah, just ask your feet.
What's that, Harold?
Oh, I said you should be up on your feet. You know, moving around, get the old circulation going.
What? The doctor just gave me a death sentence, Harold. That's what it is, you know, a death sentence. She might as well pull out a shotgun, put up beside my head, and blow it off.
I don't think general practitioners can do that. She only said that you're out of shape. She didn't say you're going to die, Glenn.
She said I couldn't drive my RV anymore. I mean, it's worse than dying. I mean, what else do I have in my life?
Well, you own and operate the only marina for 20 miles.
Yeah, but something I like.
Have you seen Glenn Braxton? Oh, Glenno, huh? Hey, up and at him. Hut, 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 hut. Let's go at it.
Drop dead, Noel. I'm about to.
Hey, shape up, man. We're gonna get you back in the driver's seat. Look what I brought.
Woo! Whoa! I've heard about these diets. I'd rather stick your fingers down my throat.
This happens to be a simple, portable muscle machine. Let me demonstrate. Pull, 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 pull.
So what, I gotta smack myself with a hose to get in shape, Noel?
No, that was an accident. But I can guarantee that in 2 weeks, you could have a body like mine.
Oh, great, he's gonna saw off my legs.
Oh, fine, thank you very much. I'll have you know, mister, I'm in terrific shape.
Mm-hmm.
Harold.
Sir?
Come on over here. Try to hurt me.
Oh, no. Oh, I know this one. This is where, like, you tear out my heart and show it to me just before I die. I think enough girls have done that to me in my lifetime already. Thanks very much.
Smart lad. Red, come on. Try to hurt me.
All right. You're short and you can't get a date.
I meant physically.
No, thanks. I'm gonna drink.
Bill, get over here. Come on. Try to hurt me, huh? Come on. Yes. I meant with your hands. Wow. I wasn't ready.
Yeah. If you were going to get mugged, they'd have to phone ahead and make a reservation.
Who'd like a butter tart? Store-bought.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Whoa. Are you crazy? Half my butter tarts are stuck to the ceiling.
This man does not need a butter tart. Okay, you might as well have taken one of those things and jammed it right into his heart.
I'd like to take one of those things and jam it down your throat. Those took me 2 hours and 9 pounds of flour.
I thought you said they were store-bought.
Well, you wouldn't have noticed the difference. Now, how do you know? Glenn has given up junk food.
Whoa, whoa, no. Since when?
Since you decided to lose 20 pounds and shape up, you pathetic blubber butt.
Blubber butt, go to my little.
What are you laughing at? Tubby?
Oh, me?
Look, you got a body like a sack of tapioca.
Tapioca!
Oh, yeah, you should talk, Eddie.
Who, me?
Yes, you. The government asks you to list your first three ingredients. You'd have to list fat, fat, fat.
And what are you laughing at?
Me?
Yeah, I mean, you put out another 5 pounds, you'd have your own gravitational field.
What are you laughing at? Uh-huh. Don't say who, me. Let those jeans out one more time, you're gonna have 9 separate pieces of denim.
Okay, all right. I think we've established that you're all a little overweight. Mm-hmm. So can we get started? Now, assume this position.
Well, let's just assume I assumed it. And don't dent the floor, you guys.
Oh, fine. Harold, Braxton, are we not going to turn our bodies into lethal weapons?
At night you'll see the men sitting on the porch, chewing and spitting to the light of the propane torch. They chew and they spit till the morning light. In the future, when they eat muskrat, they'll remember to marinate it first. Ooh. This week in the handyman corner, can I show you something festive and decorative that you can do to your patio? You know, the patio up here at the lodge has not been looking all that great since we did that experiment to find out whether or not hydrogen is flammable. But you know, I think we can bring her right back up to snuff here by making our very own patio lanterns. And they're real easy to make and kind of fun. For starters, you have your Christmas lights, which are probably hanging up at your house all summer long anyhow. So why not double up with those? All you need is some of those plastic containers. You might find 2 or 3 in the garbage. I just picked these out of today's garbage up here at the lodge. And they are a little dirty. I would suggest you just let that mung just kind of dry on there, then pick it off with your thumbnail. I tried to clean one of them in the dishwasher. You know, there's a heater unit in those dishwashers, and that thing just shriveled up there like a... Well, you guys know what I'm talking about. Anyway, what you want to do is pick out one of the containers that seems the appropriate size and shape to make a patio lantern out of. Something like that, for example. And then you want to see, well, let's see which way we hang that. Well, I think kind of that kind of a look, kind of like a big plastic teat on there. outside the sun porch door there, that would look good. Then what you want to do is you want to cut an X in the bottom. You can use a carpet knife for that. I have a carpet knife in my pocket. All right, someone didn't put the blade away before they put that in my pocket. Now what you want to do here is you want to cut an X and cut it about 2 inches. Or if you're dealing in centimeters, you want to cut enough centimeters that it's 2 inches. Okay. Okay, now we've got our X, and then you just put the bulb right in there, and it's kind of a friction fit, and that's really on there. That really happens. All right, you just do that for all of them. The cutting thing, not the slapping yourself in the face thing. Unless if you want to slap yourself in the face, I would help you. By golly, that's smart. All right, that's 2. It's taking a little longer than I thought. Well,
Oh.
All right, there's actually an easier way than the carpet killer to punch the holes in these things. This would be with a power tool. Let's see if this works a little better. I think so, yeah. Get the old bleach bottle here. Oh, my. Threw that one out. Another thing you can do with a power tool is you can kind of save a little bit of time. All righty, well, we'll start to get a few more going here, and the next step will be to take our containers and stick the Christmas lights through those. I'll get a hammer and just tap those on. And by the time I finish getting everything rigged, I think it's going to be dark enough to show you how this really looks. Now you tell me, who wouldn't want to have that hanging around their house, huh? Harold, kill the lights there a minute. Right? Look at that. Good friend, good fun, good food, and margarine tubs. You know, I think this is the greatest recycling decorator's idea since cutting tires in half, painting them white, and putting them up the sides of your driveway. Oh, well. Until next time, remember, if the women don't find you handsome, they should at least find you handy. Jeez, I can't find anything. Harold, throw the lights back on, will you? Oh, geez. Thank you, Harold.
I don't know, maybe he's right, Bill. Maybe I should work out or something. Get up. I should watch what I eat. Are you going to eat that one? Yeah. Thank you.
It is summer. Two men are arm wrestling, locked in a draw for 15 minutes with their huge ham-like fists wrapped around the last beer in the house. Well, the final insurance policy arrived, and I got to go around and get everybody's signature. Let's hope nobody dies before they get to sign. That'd be a real tragedy, wouldn't it?
Uncle Red, do I have to sign on the dotted line, too? I know I'm not, like, a lodge member, but, you know, I consider myself a keen observer.
Try being a silent observer, Harold.
Oh, yeah, right.
Ah, Glenn's going around here feeling sorry for himself, which isn't that hard to do. I'll tell you, if moping burns calories, Glenn's going to drop about 40 pounds by dinner. Noel's trying to get him into shape. When Glenn's not looking, Noel goes out and moves the RV about 40 feet down the laneway so Glenn gets a little more exercise. And Noel also turned the broom closet into a sauna. Right now, there's 8 guys in there sweating it out.
Oh, yeah, what are they using for heat?
8 guys.
Ooh.
Yeah, and Glenn is drinking beer out of a heavier mug now to kind of build up the biceps, and he licks the salt off the pretzels before he eats them.
Wow, next stop, the Olympics.
Yeah, I think the problem is, you know, you are what you eat. And Eddie keeps pumping us full of pancakes and donuts and French toast and muffins, and he deep fries all that stuff.
Hurry up, Uncle Red, I'm getting hungry.
Yeah, me too. Eddie, what are you making for lunch today?
What do you see here, Red?
4 heart attacks, 3 strokes, and a hernia.
Don't you blame me because Glenn's a 300-pound weakling. Who made the high-fiber ice cream? Who made the broccoli cheesecake? Who made the artichoke yogurt surprise?
You did that on purpose?
Yesterday, I made garlic and onion donuts.
Well, obviously, threats don't work with these guys. But you know, Ed, I think you should cut down on the salt and the cholesterol, take some of the grease off the salads.
I'm not Glenn's mother, you know.
No, I know. Mind you, there is a strong resemblance. Yeah, well, something's got to be done, that's for sure. Give me another whack of that on here, would you, Ed?
Sure, there you go, Red. Oh, wait now.
Beauty. Well, this week on Adventures with Bill, I guess this means we're going to go canoeing. Bill's over there somewhere. In she goes, and... Okay, Bill. Oh, easy. Yeah, it's adventure with Bill. All right, yeah, he's fine. Okay, now I thought we'd just go paddling, but Bill said no, don't want to use the paddles.
Hey!
Oh, sorry about that. So he wanted to show us some different ways of powering a canoe here, rather than the normal conventional use of a paddle. So he's got a real nice little outboard that I wasn't exactly sure how he was going to attach it on, and I was going to swing it out to him. It's kind of heavy, so I wanted to get it. I was unfortunate. But no problem. You know, lots more outboards where that one come from. Now this one might. This one might be a little bigger than what the canoe is rated for, but we don't have to trigger on full. I hadn't realized the weight would have. Now, I don't know if bolting that onto the side is. To me, it would go on the end, but then. I'm not the expert like Bill. Anyway, so we kind of abandoned that. We were running short on the outboards, and we just got her up on the dock, dumped the water out of her. I wasn't quite sure what Bill had planned there, whether you just leave it on the dock and then what you do is you tow the dock around. No, he went and he come back with a, went up under the lodge there and got all the paddles that we use on spaghetti night. Anyway, 15, 16 paddles or so there, I guess, and didn't quite know what he had in mind, and he brung down a bunch of sea clamps and some rope there, and a little bit of this and that, started hooking the paddles onto the sides and up onto the gunnels and the sides and where the gunnels meet the sides even, and then up at the bow and down at that other one, the other end, the assistant bow, or the back, I think it's called. And now what he created here was basically the sailboat idea. There's your keel, is your four paddles on the side, and there's your main mast and your mizzen and your halyard and your mainstay and your forestay and that's okay to say that. Now what he needed was some cloth to put on. Now you want to take my shirt. I said, no way, I'm not going to give you, take your own, you hang your own clothes on. Anyway, so I pretended that I'd take mine off, he took his off, and we didn't want anybody to see this at home, so the cameraman had fatter fingers. Anyway, Bill stripped right down there, and which was a real treat for the bugs, but started attaching his clothing and what have you, and God, he loves these things, doesn't he? There he's got it. He got his pants on the front, and all I had to do was kind of look like a Viking. I thought of the Viking. Well, I figured maybe he could try the motor again. Well, just a few signatures to go, and every lodge member will be covered for death or dismemberment. You know that a hand is worth more than a foot? That surprised me. I mean, I can understand an eye being worth more than an ear, but I would think you'd rather walk somewhere with one hand than hop there with two. And you know, there's something kind of warm about the guys asking me how to spell their names. They had to use their real names there. No nicknames, except for Nick. Hey, Harold, you know what Junior Sinkman's real name is?
Larry?
David? Or Doug?
Vladimir?
Vance?
Valerie? Pig nose.
Shut up, Harold.
All right.
It's Brutus. A2 Brutus. A2 Popeye. And old man Sedgwick's real name is Old Man. No wonder he couldn't wait to grow up. Stinky Peterson, his first name is actually George. Actually, Stinky looks like a George, but he has the air of a Stinky. Oh, I'll get the rest of the signatures at tonight's meeting.
That's the cry of the wild possum, Uncle Red. It's time for the meeting. We better get down there. We have to convince Glenn that his life really is worth living.
Well, maybe you can describe your life. That'll make him feel better.
Yeah, okay.
You know, I think if the insurance company was aware of Harold's personality, they might not give us a policy. Anyway, excuse me a minute.
Wayne, you too.
My heart won't take it.
Quando, Omni, Flunkus, Moritati, Masterstroke.
Oh, Bill, I need your signature on this insurance form. Sorry. Message for me?
Oh, all right, all right. The floor recognizes Noel Christmas.
Thank you, Red. I'd just like to show you what my athlete has learned in just one day. Go on, Glenn. Show him.
Well, I can show you how I can strangle Noel.
Go for it.
These reports for the insurance investigation here. It's not Glenn that has the high cholesterol. It's Noel.
Me?
Oh, yeah, and you got high blood pressure too, Noel. But it says, Glenn, you're fine.
Great, so I can drive my RV again.
Yes, you can, sir. In fact, they say you're so relaxed, you should never need any sleep.
Yeah, with that.
Well, how can I be unhealthy? I mean, why is it me? Why me?
Well, maybe it's the way he handles stress, huh?
Yeah. It's your cooking, Eddie. That's right. You've been poisoning me with your lard-filled vein-clogging fat feast. That's what it was.
Hey. You're the only one with high cholesterol around here. Everybody else is fine. Then calm down. I'll put more grapefruit in your stupid diet.
Hey, I got an idea. Let's jump in the RV, go to Florida, and get some fresh grapefruit, huh?
I'm dying.
While Noel is getting over the good news here, unless there's some other business, no, nothing going on now. I'm going to call on our old buddy Glenn, who's in perfect health, to give us the evening's entertainment.
All right. I mean, how do I look to you?
Short.
Okay, I was going to read my last will and testament, but I think I can scare up a few slides for you guys, huh? Phil, can you get the lights?
My followers!
All righty.
And Noel would be the one with the health problem. I mean, he's always after us to eat better and get in shape, and here it is that he's the reject. How can you not believe in God when stuff like that happens? Anyway, if my wife is watching, I'll be coming straight home after the meeting, and apparently I'm in a lot better shape than I look, so I'd like to go back to not wearing any pajamas, unless there's a downside. So, until next time, on behalf of myself and Harold and the whole gang up here at Possum Lodge, keep your stick on the ice.
The ball made out of steel. It's a big ball.
Steel ball?
Yeah, steel ball.
Can you throw it?
No, it's really big. It's like, see, there's my hand, right? That's like just on the camera here.
Perspective.
Yeah.
I know about perspective.
Huge. You know, if actually that's out of the front window of the RV, if I put like myself over there, I'd be dwarfed by the thing.
Must be huge then.
Huge. It's a huge steel ball. Unbelievable. Ha ha ha!